The House of Chanel, the most famous fashion name of the 20th century, the epitome of luxury and style. Yet the woman behind this iconic brand was not born into wealth or influence. Coco Chanel's is a story of absolute rags to lavish riches. Plucked from poverty by a string of wealthy lovers, she rose from the poorhouse to create a style of liberating clothing that quite simply changed the face of women's fashion.
Dress shabbily and they remember the dress. Dress impeccably and they remember the woman.
Yet behind the ruthlessly manicured public image lies a tale of wartime collaboration with the Nazis and a lifetime of disastrous affairs. Always a mistress, never a wife, Coco's longing for love nearly cost her everything. Yet her determination saw her triumph in a man's world on her own terms. In the end, the House of Chanel became all she had, but she left a legacy of glamour that lasts to this day. Coco Chanel, the woman who was to transform 20th century fashion, was born to a life far from luxury. She was named Gabrielle Bonheur Chanel, born on the 19th of August, 1883, in Saumur, in France's Loire Valley. Gabrielle was delivered to her scandalously unmarried parents in a poorhouse. Her father was a market trader. She and her four brothers and sisters spent much of their childhoods in the public markets of Western France, where her father made a basic living. These were tough times for working-class women. They were second-class citizens. They could not vote and were expected to be subservient to their men, often having no option but to work as poorly paid domestic servants or laborers. This was the future Gabrielle would have expected for herself. But when she was just 12 years old, all that changed. In the winter of 1895, Gabrielle's mother died suddenly. Her father traveled to the nearby town of Aubusine and split the family. He sent his sons to live with farm laborers and his daughters to an orphanage. Gabrielle never saw her father again. The Aubusine orphanage was the largest in the region, run by disciplinarian nuns and home to hundreds of children, many abandoned by their parents. Gabrielle, left by her father and grieving the loss of her mother, spent her impressionable teenage years within this strict institute. Respite came in the form of occasional holidays when she was allowed to visit her aunts, Adrienne and Louise. Gabrielle and Aunt Louise would spend their days making clothes. She had been taught how to sew at the orphanage, but Louise taught her how to sew creatively, adding frills and pleats to embellish a simple bonnet. But at the end of the summer, Gabrielle had to return to the strict regime at the orphanage. After 7 years there, at the age of 18, she was given a choice: become a nun or leave. Gabrielle wasn't about to spend her life in a habit. she arranged to visit her Aunt Louise in the town of Moulin. From there, she enrolled at the Notre Dame Finishing School for Young Ladies. As Gabrielle had no way of paying the fees, she was one of the charity pupils there, given a free place, but treated very differently to the wealthier girls. After 2 years, aged 20, she was considered ready to face the world on her own. In 1903, Gabrielle was offered a job as a seamstress in a tailor's. The owner liked her because she was especially skillful with a needle and thread. It was a good job for a young lady of Gabrielle's modest standing, but she didn't see any future in being a seamstress. Moulin was a garrison town, and off-duty soldiers had to amuse themselves as best they could. Gabrielle began to catch the eye of several young officers who came to the shop to have their clothing tailored. They began to invite her, with her aunt Adrienne, to the local music halls. Here, Gabrielle could see a much more glamorous future. The music halls were a bawdy scene. Amateurs could take to the stage between performances, and very quickly, Gabrielle was no longer in the audience, but up on stage. Her repertoire was limited, just two songs, Coco Rico and Kikavu Coco. So the audience soon thought of her as La Petite Coco. Under the stage lights, seamstress Gabrielle could be someone else. She could become Coco Chanel. And as Coco, her onstage presence was getting her noticed. Etienne Balsin was a young infantry officer, an enthusiastic sportsman with a taste for the high life, and a millionaire. He was a frequent visitor to the music halls in Moulin, and Coco caught his eye. She was just 21. But Balsin already had one live-in mistress and no intention of settling down. Yet Coco didn't care. She didn't think of him as a potential husband. She knew that as an illegitimate orphan, she stood no chance whatsoever. But she realized he could be her meal ticket out of poverty. It wouldn't be the last time she'd use her sexual allure to get what she wanted. Just 12 months after Coco and Balsan's meeting, his old mistress had packed her bags. Coco moved in at Balsan's Grand Royaleur estate. She was now his live-in mistress, a kept woman. The role of mistress in France was something of an institution, and there'd be no more need for work in the tailor shop. Royaleur was a window into another world. Those invited to this grand estate came unaccompanied by their spouses to have fun. She passed her time learning to train and ride Balsan's horses, and she very quickly became an accomplished horsewoman. Within just a year of leaving school, Coco Chanel, the little orphan seamstress, was socializing with some of the wealthiest people in France. She was gaining confidence too, doing things differently and getting noticed. In the 1900s, fashion was as much about sexual politics as it was about clothes. The top designers were all men, and women's dresses were ornamental and not practical. Their creations forced women to be decorative, helpless creatures. Floor-length billowing skirts and breathtakingly tight corsets made even the simplest practical task a trial. But Coco thought this ridiculous. Her confidence and sense of practicality would not allow her to be a slave to her era.
Fashion has become a joke, the designers have forgotten that there are women inside these dresses.
In the summer of 1909, aged 26, she attended a racing event with Balsan and caused quite a stir. Because she wasn't wearing women's clothes at all. That day, Coco wore one of Balsan's ties and a coat belonging to one of his friends. It was a practical and sporty look and definitely considered male attire. She topped it off with a boater she'd made herself. Society women couldn't believe her audacity, but they had to admire it. She began to think she was onto something. Balsan indulged Coco's forays into fashion. He gave her a space in his apartment to design and make hats for her friends, just as she had as a child with her Aunt Louise. But Coco didn't want just a hobby. She wanted a profession, a business. But as a woman without money, she would never be able to launch a business by herself. Then someone entered her life, someone who understood her desire to make something of herself and who wanted to help her achieve it. Arthur Capel was known to his friends as Boy. He was wealthy, a polo player and a playboy like Balsan, but that's where the similarities ended. Boy was British and the only one in the group who worked for a living. And by 1909, Coco was not just Balsan's mistress, but Boy's as well. The true circumstances of Coco's first meeting with Boy Capel remain a mystery. Later in life, Coco would give a variety of elaborate accounts, the most romantic being they found themselves riding alone through meadows beneath the snow-capped Pyrenees. But however starry-eyed their first meeting, the self-made Capel quickly recognized Coco's personal drive and business ambitions. And she recognized he could be the perfect person to help and encourage her to forge a career. But there was much more to it than that. In the summer of 1909, Coco decided she no longer needed Etienne Balsan. She left him a scribbled note.
My dear Etienne, I shall never be able to repay the kindness and comfort you have given me while I've been with you. I am leaving with Boy Capel. Forgive me, but I love him.
She followed Capel to Paris that day. Paris in the 1900s was in stark contrast to the rundown markets and town squares of Coco's poor upbringing. This was the Belle Époque, a golden age of artistic freedom and personal indulgence. And Paris was the place to be. Home to the rich, the famous, and the beautiful. Coco was socializing with the most sophisticated and well-connected in the city. And with Boy Capel's money, she could fulfill her dreams. Yet Coco had not abandoned her old boyfriend Balsan entirely. So, within a year of her arrival in Paris, Capel and Balsan struck a deal jointly to fund Coco's very first venture, a hat shop at 21 Rue Cambon.
They had decided to give me a place where I could make my hats, the way they would have given me a toy.
The hat shop caused a stir because Coco's creations were so very different and not at all in the usual elaborate and cumbersome fruit bowl style. Coco's passions were simplicity and modernity, allowing women to be stylish and practical at the same time.
Nothing makes a woman look older than obvious expensiveness, ornateness, complication.
The shop was a huge success. But for Coco, the hats were just the beginning. The seaside town of Deauville in southern Normandy was 6 hours by train from Paris. With one of the best beaches for miles around, Deauville was a fashionable holiday resort. A favorite of royalty and emperors, it was cosmopolitan and the place for the rich and famous to be seen. And these were just the sort of people Coco wanted to attract. So it was here that Coco chose to take her next step. In 1913, and once again with Boy Capel's financial backing, the doors opened on a new Chanel store. But this time, it was not just a hat shop, but Coco's first fashion boutique. Coco's was the first couture collection for women, designed exclusively by a woman. There were no frills, no ruffles or corsets. It was simple, it was stylish, but above all, it was practical.
I want to give women the possibility to laugh and eat without necessarily having to faint.
No one had seen anything quite like it. The collection was a triumph and Coco's reputation was sealed. But then the whole world changed. In the summer of 1914, Europe was plunged into a devastating conflict. World War I saw 65 million men on the front lines. Over 8 million were killed and 21 million wounded. Swathes of the French countryside were churned into miles of bloody, muddy trenches. Everywhere there was scarcity and hardship. This was no time for high fashion. Yet amid the misery and despair, the war revealed an opportunity for Coco. French society was changing. With most of the men away at war, it was left to women to pick up their men's working roles, delivering mail, driving buses and trams, and making munitions. Women were holding France together. But their traditional corseted dresses weren't just impractical, they were dangerous to wear in factories with machinery. Wartime women needed functional working clothes. This was Coco's natural style through and through. She grabbed her chance and began to create new wartime designs. And then came the breakthrough. Women's fancy fabrics were hard to find, but there was plenty of jersey, the stretchy woolen fabric used to make men's undergarments. Coco decided to transform necessity into style and create a small collection of jersey daywear for women. The collection was a success. She had found a niche, tapped into her natural talents, and come out with a winning formula.
A world was dying, while another was being born. I was there. An opportunity came forward, and I took it.
Through the war years, Coco and Boy Capel's romance grew, as did Coco's business opportunities. In the summer of 1915, he arranged a holiday for them both. He whisked Coco off to the seaside spa town of Biarritz, near the border with neutral Spain. Biarritz was a haven for the wealthy, and those able to travel would flock to the town to forget their war worries. But Coco didn't relax entirely. She soon realized that Biarritz could offer the same possibilities as Deauville, While all around her was collapsing under the pressures of war, Coco was preparing to expand her empire. In 1915, Coco opened another Chanel couture boutique in Biarritz, and with it came a sense of independence.
I was my own master, and I depended on myself alone. Boiscapel was well aware he didn't control me. "I thought I'd given you a plaything. I gave you freedom," he once said to me in a melancholy voice.
The House of Chanel was well and truly established. On November the 11th, 1918, an armistice was signed. The war was over. It should have been a time of jubilation for Coco. She had turned wartime necessities into a winning formula for her business. And both she and Boiscapel had come through the war unscathed. But within weeks, Capel betrayed her. In 1918, he announced his intention to marry an aristocratic English beauty and daughter of a lord. Coco was distraught. She admitted she had only ever truly loved once.
"We were made for each other, that he was there and that he loved me and that he knew I loved him was all that mattered."
After his wedding, Coco and Capel continued their affair. But for Coco, the worst of it was that she was now not Capel's sole partner, but merely his part-time mistress. Then in 1919, things got even worse. Late on the evening of the 21st of December 1919, Boiscapel was killed in a car crash. If she was crushed by the news of his marriage, then she was utterly broken by his death.
"I lost everything when I lost Capel."
Boy had supported and loved her despite the social stigma of her modest background. Now she was alone. Coco blamed the social elite for Boy's loss, and she wanted revenge.
"All those blue bloods, they turn their noses up at me, but I'll have them groveling at my feet."
Coco was going to show just how ruthless she could be. She would join high society and make it worship her. Her first step was, very deliberately, to rewrite her own history, romanticizing and reinventing her childhood. Coco told so many different stories about who she was and where she came from that many felt it was no longer possible to know the real Coco. Her next step was to move her Paris couture shop to larger, more luxurious premises at 31 Rue Cambon. The polished image and move worked. With her fashion empire once again booming, doors were open to her. The rich, famous, and royalty alike all wanted to be associated with her chic, stylish image. In 1919, as a mark of her intentions, she took an apartment at the renowned Ritz Hotel, one of the most luxurious and prestigious in the world. There, she shamelessly used sex to enhance her status. Men became mere trophies to her.
"I developed the habit, then unprecedented, of surrounding myself with people of quality so as to establish a link between myself and society."
In the early 1920s, her self-styled Slavic period, she had an affair with Russian composer Igor Stravinsky. She even had an affair with the richest man in England, the Duke of Westminster. Bendor Grosvenor met Coco in Monte Carlo in the Christmas of 1923. He was said to be enchanted by her and sent her love letters, flowers, and baskets of fruit, and made the hugely extravagant gesture of flying them all the way from London to her home in France. She spent her summers with the Duke, dividing her time between his townhouses in London and country home in Cheshire. She socialized with his friends, incorporated his tweeds into her fashion designs, and even met his friend Winston Churchill, the then British Chancellor of the Exchequer. As time went by, there were rumors of marriage, but this never materialized.
He wasn't free, and nor was I. I didn't want to leave the House of Chanel, which I had built all by myself and continuously reshaped.
This, of course, wasn't true. Bendor Grosvenor could never have married her. But meanwhile, her empire was expanding. France had rebounded from World War I with jubilation. By the 1920s, the era of corsets was well and truly over. Modern girls were flappers, and they were out to have fun. It was as if the world of fashion had caught up with Coco's style ideas. Her designs, as always, were based upon how she liked to dress.
Dress shabbily, and they remember the dress. Dress impeccably, and they remember the woman.
With Coco at the helm of the House of Chanel, innovation followed innovation. In 1923, Coco made a daring move and launched a perfume. Named after her lucky number, Chanel No. 5 was the world's most expensive. In 1926, she introduced her signature little black dress. American Vogue predicted it would become a uniform for all women of taste. And she was one of the first to put women into chic, stylish trousers. Time and again, with every collection through the 20s and early 30s, she was defying convention and redefining how women dressed. She was now an industry leader in a previously male-dominated world, and by having a career and enjoying a liberated love life, she symbolized the post-war aspirations of a generation of newly emancipated women.
I was the first person to live the life of this century.
Her prestige had never been higher. But very soon, a chain of events was set in place that would see her risk it all.
Zusammen mit schweren Waffen tragen die Grenadiere den Gegenangriff vor.
On the 1st of September 1939, Germany invaded Poland. Just 2 days later, Britain and France declared war. Hitler set out to spread his Nazi empire across Europe in a conflict that would be the most deadly and destructive in history. France didn't immediately fall under attack, and in Paris, Coco's clients begged her to keep her boutiques open for morale. But in May 1940, the Nazis attacked, and thousands of civilian refugees clogged roads throughout France. Coco laid off her staff and closed the House of Chanel. Only one small perfume store remained open. When the streets began to empty, as Parisians fled in their thousands, Coco joined them, The difference being, she was in a chauffeur-driven car. In June 1940, German forces bombed Paris. Within days, France surrendered. An agreement was made. The Nazis would occupy and govern northwestern France, and a new collaborationist French government, based in the town of Vichy, would run the south of the country. Coco spent the next few weeks reflecting upon what she should do. She had successfully steered the House of Chanel through one world war, and she began to think she might be able to do the same again. Giving up was not her style, and the House of Chanel was now the only thing she valued in her life. So in August 1940, Coco decided what she must do, and once again, she headed back to Paris and to the Ritz Hotel.
Auch Paris bietet mehr und mehr ein normales Bild. Generalfeldmarschall Hermann Göring.
But the Paris she returned to was occupied and swarming with German soldiers. The German army had even commandeered the Ritz as its headquarters. But she was able to take a small room in the civilian wing of the hotel and use it as her new Paris base. Coco, as always, was intent on survival and bent to the times. By day, her perfume boutique was selling to the wives of Nazi officers. And by evening, she was living cheek by jowl with Nazi commanders. But by 1941, Coco's relatively benign relationship with the German occupiers began to change. She was feeling her age and unhappy about the decline in her looks. She told a friend that when looking in a mirror, she found it
a struggle between it and me.
It was around this time that she met Hans Günther von Dinklager, known as Spatz. He was a German officer and Nazi spy, something of a playboy and 13 years her junior. Coco dined with him, asking his help to release her nephew, who had been detained. During the negotiations, she and Spatz became lovers. She was 56 years old. Spatz may have been German, but Coco didn't seem to mind. She later claimed,
"Really, a woman of my age cannot be expected to look at his passport if she has a chance of a lover."
But then Coco's more senior Nazi connections led her to become involved in a sinister plot. One evening, Coco and Spatz dined with cavalry captain Theodore Mom. They began to discuss the future of the hostilities and to think maybe Coco herself could play a role in ending the war. After all, Coco had spoken of the Duke of Westminster and had regaled stories of mixing with Churchill. She'd been partner and lover to an Englishman for 8 years. She knew both the English mindset and had friends with influence.
"You Germans don't know how to handle the English. I do."
Not even Coco could have realized what she was getting herself into. Coco traveled to Berlin and was introduced to Walter Schellenberg, Hitler's chief of foreign intelligence and personal aide to Heinrich Himmler. By now, Schellenberg was convinced the Nazis would lose the war and was desperate to cut a deal with the Allies to gain peace with honor. There and then, the bizarre Operation Modelhut was conceived. Even today, the full details of the plot remain secret. But it is thought Coco was to be used as bait to lure Churchill into a meeting where he could be persuaded to make peace on terms favorable to the Nazis. Coco traveled to neutral Spain, where she planned to meet the British ambassador, Sir Samuel Hoare. She hoped that he, a man with a reputation for negotiating delicate international deals, would arrange a secret face-to-face meeting with Churchill. It seemed Coco had overstated her real influence with the British. Hoare did not take the bait and said Churchill was too ill for any meeting. Operation Modelhut had come to nothing. Yet Coco was now on record as having collaborated in a Nazi plot. She returned to the Ritz apartment in Paris and to her German lover. But by now, the tide of war was turning against Hitler. On the 6th of June 1944, the Allies' Operation Overlord was put into action. And the beaches of Normandy flooded with Allied troops in the largest amphibious operation in history. The Allies defeated and began to push back German army units. On the 25th of August 1944, Paris was liberated. The next day, General de Gaulle and leaders of the French resistance marched in celebration from the Arc de Triomphe to Notre Dame. Thousands gathered to witness the liberation. It was a huge spectacle. France was once again free. Coco watched the scene unfold from a balcony on the Rue de Rivoli. She must have sensed a change in mood. Among those who had collaborated with the Nazis, fear was growing. Nazi officers were interrogated and collaborators rooted out. Thousands of female collaborators were rounded up, stripped and paraded in the streets, their hair shorn in public humiliation. As the lover of a Nazi officer, Coco's position was vulnerable. Worse, there was her role as a Nazi agent in Operation Modelhut. She would surely be found guilty of collaboration. In August 1944, just 2 weeks after de Gaulle's march, two men arrived at the Ritz. They handed Coco an arrest order from the Committee of Public Morals. She was named a Nazi spy. Under interrogation, Schellenberg had revealed every detail of Operation Modelhut. He claimed Coco Chanel was at its center. Coco picked up her gloves and bag and calmly walked out of the door with her captors. The woman who had risen from the poorhouse to a position of enormous wealth and influence, and who had single-handedly revolutionized fashion, was set to be denounced as a Nazi agent and publicly paraded for all to see. Once the embodiment of the modern, liberated woman, Coco Chanel was now labeled as a collaborator. Yet just a few hours later, Coco was released without charge. Coco Coco would never confirm exactly what happened, but some say she knew too much about the British upper classes. Others claim Churchill personally intervened on her behalf. But whatever the reason, Coco avoided public humiliation. Yet her reputation was damaged beyond repair. France turned against her. It was now unsafe for her to remain in Paris. So Coco packed her bags at the Ritz and bought a one-way ticket to Switzerland, where her German lover Spatz was waiting for her. The dream was effectively over. In Switzerland, bitterness set in. Coco had lost the two things that mattered most to her, her reputation and her empire. She stopped designing altogether and lived in comfort on the fortune she had made selling her perfume to the Nazis.
Starting at the Place de la Concorde on a midnight tour of Paris, designer Pierre Balmain.
Quietly and from the sidelines, Coco witnessed the changes in post-war French fashion. And she despised what she saw. In 1947, Christian Dior introduced the new look, a cascade of nipped waists, longer lengths, and fuller skirts, with yards and yards of fabric. Ruffles found their way to skirt hems, necklines, and waists. Gathered skirts were topped with soft, feminine detailing. Coco saw Dior's designs as standing against everything she had achieved for women. Coco was convinced that women would soon be desperate to throw off the waist cinches, padded bras and heavy skirts, and return to a more practical approach. She began to think fashion once again needed her. But there was more to it than that. Coco's personal life was empty. Although she was still paying him an allowance, she and her lover Spatz had split. Former lovers Etienne Balsan and the Duke of Westminster had both died. Even Nazi spymaster Walter Schellenberg, for whom she had paid costly medical bills, was dead. Coco was alone and in need of a distraction. She realized the time was now right for her style to make a comeback. So in 1954, she began to prepare for what was to be the most important collection of her life. On the 5th of February, age 73, Coco Chanel returned to Paris, to the world of fashion. Here, she would launch her first post-war collection. She had worked tirelessly. Every dress was inspected and re-inspected. The models were poked, prodded, and pinned round the clock. To Coco, this show meant everything, and the stakes could not have been higher. She would either make a triumphant comeback or face humiliation. The French press were scathing. They had not forgiven her for her wartime collaboration. The British press called it a fiasco, the same old styles with nothing new. But redemption did come, this time from overseas. It was the Americans who were in raptures. The unchanged simplicity and classic elegance of the Chanel look won them over. Practical yet luxurious clothing was sought after by American working women, and Coco was there to dress them in style.
I don't like people talking about the Chanel fashion. Chanel, above all else, is a style. Fashion, you see, goes out of fashion. Style, never.
In 1962, Broadway producers even proposed a musical of Coco's life story. She considered the female lead, Katharine Hepburn, nearly 20 years her junior, to be too old for the role. In time, France forgot Coco's wartime history. Europe, too, fell for her designs. The House of Chanel was bigger and better than ever. Coco herself was idolized. In the late 1960s, the House of Chanel was a worldwide fashion colossus, worth over £100 million, with Coco, the Grand Mademoiselle, at its helm. For the second time in a century, Coco Chanel had made her fortune. She was now wealthier and more successful than ever. But for all the successes, beneath the carefully manicured image, Coco was increasingly frail and lonelier than ever. The men she had loved were long dead. She had never married and had no close family, and was now utterly reliant on nightly morphine sedatives to help her sleep.
One shouldn't live alone. It's a mistake. I used to think I had to make my life on my own, but I was wrong. I've got nothing. I am alone with my millions.
Yet despite her lifelong search for love, Coco Chanel had risen to the top in a male-dominated world to create a style of clothing that had changed the face of women's fashion. By 1971, Coco, orphan, mistress, millionaire, was growing increasingly frail and difficult. On the 10th of January, at the age of 88, and still officially working, Coco Chanel, a fashion industry icon, died at her Ritz apartment. Her maid was with her for her last moments. As Coco pushed one last syringe of nightly morphine into her leg, she said,
"You see, this is how one dies."